You know, I've always been committed to lifelong learning, be that medicine or as an entrepreneur. And you really can't learn EKGs without studying Dubin's, and you really can't get a good foothold on enduring businesses without studying Jim Collins' work. Great by choice, and that's what I'd like to summarize for you here. For the other entrepreneurs out there who are lifelong learners, my hope is this is either a catalyst for you to learn deeply and to go get the book, or hopefully just embrace some of these principles. Great by Choice was a 9-year study started in 2002 to answer one question: why do some companies thrive in uncertainty and others don't? And he identified industries that he called 10Xers, or companies within an industry, like Microsoft and Southwest Airlines. Companies that really exceeded the competition, at least by 10 times. Interestingly, Southwest Airlines, Money Magazine ranked it the best industry that's been around the last few decades, where it beat the market by 63 times, but it beat the industry, the airline industry, by 550 times. So if you would have invested $10,000 in 72, you in 2002 would have had $12 million. So it's the ultimate 10Xer. And they found three points that the 10Xers had. They had fanatical discipline, they empirically were creative, and they had productive paranoia. So they were disciplined, creative, and paranoid. So let's break down those three features. Now, Jim Collins talked about two groups of people that were racing towards the South Pole in the early 1900s. You had Edmondson, Ronald Edmondson, and he decided he was going to take his team 20 miles every single day, irregardless of the weather. And he had Robert Scott. That Scott's travel strategy was conditional, meaning if it was really nice out, they'd go way more than 20 miles in one day. But if it was really bad, he would preserve the strength of himself and his team. Well, what ended up happening? Well, Edmondson not just won, he won by a huge margin, and Scott and his team in the process died. So fanatical discipline has to do with consistency. So the best performing leaders exhibit discipline as consistency of action, their values, long-term goals, performance standards, and their consistency of methods. And they stay very focused to the hedgehog concept, which I'll talk about in the next video. Now, what makes a good 20-mile march? Well, it's got to be consistent. Your intentions don't count. It's got to be consistent with action. It's got to be challenging yet achievable within your control. It's got to be industry specific. Once again, you have to be able to control it, and your timing's got to be right. Now, a personal note on this is in 2005, I finished a Lake Placid Ironman, and it took a year to train for it, but I had a coach, and I just did what the coach told me to do. He told me to swim for 45 minutes a day and run 4 miles. Okay, fine. Go ride your bike 20 miles. I did what my coach told me. I had this discipline as instituted by my coach. Well, I tried to race it again in 2007, and I couldn't finish the race. I got a big fat DNF. It was very humbling because I trained conditionally. If I felt good, I went a long time. If I didn't feel good, I didn't train very much that day. So in my life, I've seen how that's really been true. Empirical creativity. Now, just staying alive doesn't produce greatness. You must also create, and great leaders have the ability to empirically validate creative instincts. And he used the analogy of the musket and the cannon. And his philosophy was, if you have a target, you fire the musket a few times until you can hit the target, and then you fire the cannon, but don't fire the cannon first. And it had to do with conserving gunpowder. He said that really great businesses did a lot of testing before they put a lot of investment into any strategy. Last one is productive paranoia. Everybody knows about Custard and he and his men getting slaughtered. Now, Bill Gates constantly embraces this productive paranoia. He says, fear should guide you. And he says, I consider failure on a regular basis. So should we. Now, Ed DeSteuer, I had the privilege of hearing him speak. He was a mountaineer up with the IMAX team. And in 1996, there was a fatal accident that happened up on that mountain. And Ed DeSteuer was with David Brashear. They were on the IMAX team, and they were going to do some filming up there. And it was on May 8th of 1996, 25,000 feet. They were up on the mountain, and they were about to make the summit, and they looked down at Camp 3. So David Brashear, he looked down, and he saw 50 climbers coming up, two other teams coming up. And he said, you know what? I don't feel good about this. What's the worst-case scenario? He said it felt too crowded, and if there was any thing that was going to go wrong when there's 50 people up there, they can't protect themselves. So they went down where these other people were coming up. It was a beautiful day to make the summit. They're like, what are you doing? He's like, we're going to make it tomorrow. We're going to go up tomorrow. So on the mountain that day, there was a guy named Scott Pfister, and he ran a company called Mountain Madness. There was Rob Hall, and he was considered the man at the time. He ran a company called Adventure Consultants, and David Brashear and his IMAX team. Now, here's Scott Fisher talking about the adventure.
It's my livelihood, and I hope that I can do a good job for people. I started out my business, Mountain Madness, to have fun, to support my lifestyle. It's pretty much my job to, I guess, number one, keep them alive, and number two, to do everything we can to get them to the summit.
Now, at the end of this trip, Scott Fisher was dead, Rob Hall was dead, but David Brashear and his team lived. They even helped to rescue some of the members of the other team. Now, where was the critical decision made? Where was the critical decision that David Brashear made that saved their life? Now, you could easily say, well, it was on the mountain. It was on the mountain when they turned around. It was not. That decision was made months and months earlier in the United States. That's when the decision made that was critical, because they planned. They planned, and what they did was they prepared. They adequately prepared for these emergencies, and they brought enough oxygen tanks so they could go down in the day they went down, so they could go back up another day. They had all these supplies. The other two teams didn't have the supplies, so they had to go up. So the critical decision was in the preparation. Now, great businesses look at three different risks. They have death line risks, and if these things happen, the business completely closes their doors. And they're always thinking, how do we mitigate these risks? Asymmetrical risks and uncontrollable risks. So there's three different risks: death line risk, asymmetrical, and uncontrollable. And great businesses always look at those risks, and at times they don't take action, but you should take action before you're forced to because the risk profile changes. So you always want to ask yourself and your team, how do I prepare for the bad days ahead? What will absolutely kill us? What's just a bad bet? What's outside of our control? And how long do we have to make those decisions? Now, search satisficing is a cognitive deficiency that we have that, according to the Harvard Business Review, if you employ this within your business, your return on investment is anywhere from 4% to 6%, and it costs you nothing. The concept is called search satisficing. So if you look at that green line, if you're going to make a decision, the higher you go up, the more satisfied you are, the better the answer is. But the problem is, we think only to a point where we have a sufficient answer. So search satisficing is where it satisfies what we want to do and it's sufficient, but oftentimes we don't overthink it. Oftentimes we decide what we want to do and go, yeah, that sounds good. Instead, we should pause and say, wait a second, is this a key decision that we have to think through and maybe come with a more optimal answer, not just a search satisficing answer? Next, I'm going to go to his next book. Jim Collins' next book was called Good to Great. Now, why do so few companies grow to great companies? That's the question. He said, well, there's so many good companies that there's not that many great companies because good keeps you complacent. It's the companies that were good that all of a sudden jumped to a great stature. So how did that happen? Well, to qualify, this was a 15-year cumulative stock returns that were good, and all of a sudden, pow, this turning point. And that accumulated to returns at least three times the market over the next 15 years. So it was a study. Now, he looked at a number of different companies like Abbott Laboratories, Wells Fargo, and that were better than the market consistently. And what he did was he found a number of different things that they embrace. So he said leadership, the people. So the disciplined people are your leadership, and then first two, then what? Brutal discipline. They confronted the brutal facts and the hedgehog concept, and then a disciplined action. So a cultural discipline and these technology accelerators. So let's look at that. What's a level five leader? Now, a level five leader has two major qualities. They're the ones that will burn their boats. You know the story about Vikings that land on an island and they're overmatched on the island, and they get off their boat on the land and the commander burns all the boats. So either they're going to take the island or they're going to be killed. So that's that unbelievable discipline. But a level five leader also has tremendous humility. They sit on the back of the bus. So you could think of it this way, the mirror versus the window. The mirror is used whenever something goes wrong. The leader looks in the mirror at himself or herself and says, hey, how did I go wrong? If there's praise to be given, they're always looking outside of the window at their team. So if you are a level one leader, you're capable. You're capable of doing your job. Level two, yeah, you're kind of on the team. I mean, you help cover shifts. You work with others. If you're level three, you're a manager. You're a man. If you're level four, you are committed, and yes, you have a vision, but you're a little too self-serving, okay? Where level five has that vigorous, passionate commitment and the humility. Next, it's first who, then what. So you need the right people. They got to have the right people on the bus and in the right seats. That's key. And how do you know that? You got to look at your core values. And if you do not have core values, you have to identify them, okay? In Gina Wickman's book, Traction, they do a really good job at helping you figure out what exactly your core values are. Then you ask, do the people who are in their seats, do they get it? Do they want it? And can they achieve it, okay? Next is confront the brutal facts. Now, James Stockdale was a fighter pilot who was shot down in Vietnam, and he spent 9 years in a POW camp. And when they asked him, James, why did you live? He said what is now called the Stockdale Paradox. And the Stockdale Paradox was, he said, number one, he was brutally honest with the facts. And the brutal honest facts were that he was probably going to die in his POW camp. But he also had faith. Okay, so he knew that he may die, and that's what we need to do within our business. We cannot avoid conflict. We have to look at what's wrong and face it. Next is the hedgehog concept. Now, the hedgehog is compared to the fox, where the fox is always scurrying around, jumping and chasing things. The hedgehog goes to eat, and if he sees danger, just rolls up into a ball. So the hedgehog does very simple things. He asks, what's my highest economic denominator? What am I passionate about? And what could I be the best at the world at? And where that overlaps, that's what hedgehogs do. And that's where they stay. They don't start getting outside of those three circles. What makes them money? What are they fired about? And what are they the best at the world at? That overlap is your hedgehog concept. Okay? Culture of discipline. It's like the Marine Corps. Fill your culture with self-disciplined people who are willing to go to extreme lengths to fulfill their responsibilities. You've got to be disciplined. And I'm saying this to myself. Now, in The Road Less Traveled by Scott Peck, he said discipline really is the solution to all of our problems. He was very adamant about that. And he said there's four major disciplines: delayed gratification, dedication to the truth, accepting responsibility, and balance. It is an absolutely fantastic book, The New Psychology of Love, Traditional Values, and Spiritual Growth. I highly recommend it. Next is technology accelerators. And what he said was technology is not going to make or break your company, but it will accelerate it. Don't think a technological advance is going to catapult you to the next dimension. It's just how you use it to accelerate your growth, but it won't catapult you. So in conclusion, discipline, creativity, and paranoia. You want to manage your risk. That's your death line risk, your asymmetrical risk, and your unexpected risk. That's great by choice. And good to great is level five leadership. Who first, then what? Confront the brutal facts, the hedgehog concept, culture of discipline, and technology accelerators. Cool. I hope this helped. If you have any questions, please post them on the video. I'll try to answer them. But I'm a big fan of helping businesses grow. I get the privilege of doing that through the University of Buffalo and some other entrepreneur groups. Good luck. God bless.